Good evening and welcome to tonight's episode of the Safety for Free series at our Brazilian Pilots Teaching for Free channel. Tonight we're going to have a very special guest, Dr. Nicklas Dahlstrom. Dr. Nicklas is a human factors manager at Emirates Airlines. He's been in such a position since 2007, and he has overseen CRM training and been part of the efforts to integrate human factors into the organization. Dr. Nicklas also holds the position of assistant professor at Lund University School of Aviation in Sweden, and was previously a researcher and instructor there, working mainly on projects related to safety and human factors in aviation, as well in other areas such as maritime transportation and healthcare. Nicklas did his PhD with Professor Sidney Dekker as a supervisor and worked with him on research projects until he joined Emirates in 2007. He was instrumental in pioneering Lund University School of Aviation as a competence center for human factors, successful cooperation with Professor Dekker on research and consultation. His research areas in aviation have been mental workload, training and simulation, and he has written research articles and book chapters on human factors and CRM, as well as delivered presentations, lectures, and training in more than 20 different countries. Previous to his career in academia and civil aviation, Dr. Nicklas was an officer and meteorologist in the Swedish Air Force, where he also underwent flight training on the SAAB 105 twin-engine trainer jet aircraft. He worked in the Swedish Air Force at the Air Base Foxtrot 10, in as well as the Swedish Fighter Pilot School Foxtrot 5, where he was also an instructor for both pilots and meteorologists. For his PhD thesis, Dr. Nicklas' subject was exploring levers for improving of basic civil aviation training. Dr. Nicklas, be welcome to our Safety for Free series. It is a privilege to have you on board on today's episode, and I'm sure that the audience is going to be thrilled by the information and knowledge that you're going to be sharing tonight. We are very fortunate to have someone with your knowledge. And right now, we have this series of videos about human factors that are quite brilliant. We talk a lot in our Safety for Free series about threat thought briefing, error management, and people are very curious about how we can mitigate those threats and avoid getting into a trap, eventually getting into an accident. I will never forget that ground school day when you came up with a very simple solution, an iPad game. And that game where you had this decision-making process on diverting an aircraft, checking for the weather and anomalies, and working as a group, very simple, basic environment, but very effective training. So hats off for you for that. Welcome to Safety for Free series.
Thank you very much, Ronald. That's a very generous and charitable introduction. I am very grateful for that, and I'm happy to be on. And thanks for all your kind words. Yes, there is a lot of ground to cover. I'll be happy to come back if your audience so requires. I'm absolutely sure we will run out of time before we run out of topics. I'll be happy to start wherever you want and be led by your questions and the curiosity of your audience.
We just had an episode talking about this recent crash in Jakarta with the 737-500, which although we are in an initial stage with the preliminary report only, it points out to something that's been considered one of the biggest threats in aviation on the last few years, according to ICAO, EASA, and NASA, which is a loss of control in flight, LOC-I. And we know since Air France 447 happened, the industry has been making a huge effort to implement UPR3 training, upset prevention and recovery training, which we are doing a lot here in our airline. Can you give us an idea of how you as a human factors specialist could look at similar events or this particular event and describe what your thoughts about it? How can an experienced trained crew with an airworthy aircraft in conditions that were not that challenging as we know at this point, could get into such a trap and end up in unusual attitude and eventually crashing in such a short time frame?
I would always be reluctant to comment on an ongoing investigation, but what we can assume, I think your comment about LOC-I is very relevant, and there seems to be something, at least the best guess for now, is something involved with auto throttle. That leads the thoughts to, of course, to startle, which was highlighted at Air France 447. And to many, that was a new thing at the time. But if you knew the research, it actually wasn't. startle is sort of just a rewrite of the same phenomenon that was called automation surprise in the 1980s. So this is well documented in the human factors literature, but the typical effects that many pilots have experienced, what is it doing now? And we know that it takes some certain time to recover, and you don't have access to your full mental faculties after a startle. This is also well documented. It might take 30 up to 60 seconds or even more before you are fully there again. So one thing I often say when I try to teach this is that, you know, pilots want things simple, right? What I say when people ask for advice about startle, I say, first do nothing. If you can, look, if your aircraft is half upside down, you have to do something. But generally, the first rule is first do nothing and then do something. So the trick here is that I try to tell pilots that you should have a plan for what to do when you don't know what to do. And what I mean with that is that every pilot should have their own little ritual. I usually take as an example, change the distance of the radar. It's not going to kill you. It's not going to do anything bad. But it's something you know, and you feel the sense of control. And usually that sense of control leads you back to the situation, back to thinking about what you're going to do in a constructive way. So thereby, my advice for these type of startle situations is first do nothing, then do something.
Move a click backwards with your seat, or sit on your hands and take a deep breath and have a look at the big picture, and then start assessing what's going on.
Yeah, because the illusion of control is incredibly important sometimes. If we feel we have control, we can go forward. But that moment when we don't know what's going on is really difficult to get out of sometimes. And my favorite example, since we're both older guys and been around a little bit here, is, of course, United Airlines 232 at Sioux City. And if you looked at the video reenactment of that event, pilots knew that they only have differential power control of the aircraft, but they still held on to the controls. Now, why would you do that? Because it feels better. So what we can do in a startle situation is have that ritual, which gives us the illusion of control, which then allows us to get back and take control.
We had a previous episode on the Amazon Prime 767 crash in Houston, which similarly went from a totally controlled flight at 6,000 feet to a crash into the ground within a 26 seconds period. And on this particular case, the recent crash in Jakarta, so we are talking about a 22 to 24 seconds time frame. So one of the questions that I would like to go a little deeper on that, when you talk about startle, and you thought, yeah, it can be from 30 to 60 seconds, depends on the individual. How does this process happen? Because there's an initial moment where you're totally out, you don't have a clue what's going on, and then you start catching up in reality, eventually analyzing to be able to start making a decision. Could you explain this process a little better?
First of all, in reflection to what you're saying, is that we should be careful to not confuse that operationally these events look the same, which they do, the events you mentioned, but the actual reasons for them, what happened in the cockpit, might be very different. Okay. So that's one point I just want to put across. And also, of course, there are times when you don't have time to sit on your hands or to do a ritual. And that's why we trained UPRT, as you mentioned, to have a reflex to handle these situations when you need to do something right now. However, there are also situations when we need to take that moment. And what usually happens here is that we have the amygdala in the brain basically sending out certain signals. And to make it simple, what they do is they close the door to the library. As a trainer, you've probably seen this. You have a trainee who is he knows everything. He can answer every question. And then you go into the sim and you put him in a difficult situation and suddenly he seems to know nothing. It's not because the knowledge isn't there. It's because that part of the brain is pretty much blocked off. The door to the library is closed. You can't get it, what you need for that moment. And that's two things there. Whenever we have these situations where we need to react a second, it must be incredibly well trained. And in other situations, please take the time to make sure you can access the library before you do something.
That's a pretty good example that the first officer had a pretty bad reaction to the situation after he went through the startle and reacted. And that was something that was already happening during training. There are recorded evidence on that.
Yeah, I think also we really have to be careful, and especially as I know you studied human factors of hindsight bias and painting in our own motives. I remember walking around the corridors after Air France 447 And people say, you know, how could they not point the nose down in a stall situation? Well, first of all, do they understand what a stall situation is? And many of my colleagues have a Air Force or fighter pilot background. And I asked in response, how often do you point the nose of a 330 downwards? Which is very rare in the operation at all. And to ask for someone that they're going to come up with that solution if it's not well trained in a split second stressful situation, it's not going to happen.
Yeah, and it's very important to mention that because I always like to look at those accidents under an organizational approach, what's relevant for that outcome. And it's not about looking at the pilot itself. There's a series of things that happened in the past, maybe during the hiring process, during the training, and decisions that were made by the airline, and that eventually can put that individual in a situation where in that split of the second, he's not ready to act. And then remember that we are talking about a highly automated flight deck. And on the Air France, it's very clear that when the captain came back from his rest and suddenly he dropped in the middle of this chaos, he just couldn't figure out what was going on, what triggered the whole initial event. So that makes it really hard to understand and act accordingly or act in a proper way. Coming back a little bit, one of the things that you've been studying, and you have one of those videos which has to do about monitoring. We always see a lot of failures in the monitoring side of the operation where we have the pilot flying and we have the pilot monitoring. And both roles are paramount for the safety of the flight. Could you give us some ideas of how to be a better monitor and how eventually this eye tracking project may help you to understand how to monitor in a more effective way?
No, I'd be happy to talk about that. I had concerns when monitoring became more of a topic in the industry. We had the UKCA was first out with their report, Monitoring Matters. We then had IATA, we had Flight Safety Foundation. All good reports, but I had a little bit of a concern that there would be a drift to telling people to look in place A, B, C and start to program it. Luckily, that hasn't happened, but I don't think we have really good solutions to training monitoring. I should say that this just about a week ago, a report came out from NASA by Randy Mumau, ex-Boeing currently at NASA, about monitoring. I haven't had the time to read through it fully, but I think that would be quite a valuable contribution. So I encourage everyone to find that one and read it. But the point I would like to make is that monitoring is a knowledge-driven activity. You look where it makes sense to look. So the better knowledge you have, the better mental model you have of the aircraft, of its operation, of automation, you will know where to look because it makes sense to look. It's incredibly important to not make monitoring an exercise of where you should look as a certain pattern only. That can be helpful at times, but I think it's a very strong correlation between understanding the aircraft and the operation and the automation and being a good monitor. So I don't think you necessarily should sit in front of a screen and try to train it that way. I think it's simply about knowing, if you have a good third level SA, meaning you're good at projecting what's going to happen next, that's because you know the systems well. And if you know what's going to happen next, you're going to look where the information makes sense.
Yeah, for that, we use that pyramid here in training where knowledge is the base of the pyramid. So if you don't have that knowledge, and we did an EBTA episode here on teaching for free. People kind of like it, understanding how this whole build-up process until you get to the point where you make a decision. That was quite interesting.
Yeah, if I can add to that, Ronald, we need to appreciate that we have a safer operation than any time in aviation history. I mean, we've been quite successful as an industry, even in the last 20 years, to further press down an already low accident rate. But that also means that things go wrong more rarely. The experience you got from flying is not the same that a young pilot will get. They will see far less variety, far less different situations. So they might get startled or surprised by something that, was normal to you. And also they might not, because they haven't seen that, they might not be able to predict and monitor the same way. And this is why we have a paradox that we, in one sense, must train more the safer we get. Because you're not going to get that experience from operation. You have to get it in training.
That's right. FlySafe Foundation and several entities have gone back to basics, as we say. Because we were fortunate. We've been here 36 years flying already. We had the chance to fly using our guts, basic instrumentation. And we were forced to to use our brain to create a situational awareness. We didn't have the tools we have nowadays in the modern flight deck. My feeling is, maybe you can say something about that, that the new generation, sometimes when things go out of the script, they have to work harder to build up that basic essay in order to understand what's going on and be projected in the future.
Yeah, it's a tricky topic because, of course, we want these tools and they're largely helpful. It is still difficult. There is some precedent of thinking about this, and that is, I know that there was research in the US Air Force about doing a three-dimensional instrument that, you know, then you would always know where you were when you were upside down and so on. And it was never liked by the pilot. I also did a study on a TCAS, three-dimensional TCAS indicators. You could see in the airspace where you were, and you'd be able to go around whatever happened. It also seems to make sense. But again, the pilots didn't like that concept at all. So it seems that there is some value with getting data that you put together, and then that enhances your essay. I'm not sure if there's been more research done on that in the last few years, but there seems to be some value of putting data together to then have better essay as being compared to being served the full picture right away. Maybe you're more engaged. It forces you to consider what's going on. I can also tell you something that I think will interest you. A project we're looking at right now, me and a few researchers, and that is doing a study on the paper tiger, which sounds like going backwards in time, right? But even today, young student pilots spend hours in front of the paper tiger. What is it that makes it so good when we have much modern instruments? And I believe that you're in control of time. You decide, you know, wait, okay, I'm going through the procedure. What happens there? I look up. The automation, there's no automation to decide the time flow. You decide it. And also, you have to imagine what's going to happen. Okay, so I'm going to do my procedure. I'm going to do this. I should see 5,000 up there then. You see where I'm going? That forces you to have a mental model. Many of these modern tools give you all of that. The paper tiger, you have to drive the simulation. You have to have the mental model.
You got to build up your own mental model, and that's part of learning. The moment you're able to visualize this whole scenario and how the thing is going to develop from that point onwards, generates a knowledge of what's going to happen and how you're going to deal with that, and puts you in control of the situation.
There's a deeper point to be made here, and I wish I provide the graphics, but if not, and this is by a man named David Krakauer, a researcher which has talked about something called cognitive artifacts. So let's translate that to proper language, and that is things to think with. He divides them in two ways. First of all, he gives a few examples, like the Arabic number system, the number system we have, where we can learn to do long division, we can put things on top of each other and do multiplication. And after we've done that for a while, we can do it in our heads. So tool in reality become tool in your head. Similarly with a map. If you look at a map, it has a lot of information, but after a while you have a map in your head. You have a map, you and I have a map of Dubai in our heads, for example. So tool in reality become tool in your head. And similarly, when you were a young pilot, you did wind calculations on one of those little calculators, right? And after a while, you could calculate winds in your head. Now, this is what David Krakauer would call complementing cognitive artifacts. They leave a tool in your head. There you are. Very good. There it is still. That was quite impressive. Anyway, so complementing cognitive artifacts, you have a tool, a model in your head. Now, the problem is today, when you use a calculator, you don't get any better. When you use the FMS, you don't get any better. When you use the GPS, you don't get any better. And he calls them competing cognitive artifacts. They take something away from you. And if you consider society today, when you have all of these tools, you don't have the tools in your brain because you have them outside. I'm not saying you should throw away your smartphone because it's incredibly important. But if your smartphone remembers all your numbers, and actually, remembering numbers help you with maths, and help you with maths makes you better at assessing the trajectory of an aircraft. We don't know what we're losing, but we're definitely losing something that maybe a previous generation had in their head.
We kind of take it for granted. So when the mobile device fails, you don't know how to react until you get your paper notes and try to put your life back together. It takes some time. Better be ready. Have a backup plan.
And again, I don't want to sound like the old guy who's saying, you know, don't use these tools. Of course you should. But I think what we've seen in a number of events is that we want pilots to think first. We want them to think, roughly how much fuel should I have today? And then look down. What roughly should be the trajectory into this airport? And then check the system. So you want to have that thought process first, because if you don't have that, everything will look correct.
So Nicklas, you've been involved in this eye tracking project in Emirates and the industry also, trying to understand how to monitor in a more efficient way. My understanding, correct me if I'm wrong, that where you look at, as you mentioned, depends a lot on what's going on that particular moment, what's your background and what are your expectations. What can you give us in terms of guidance on how to monitor better?
Eye tracking is still being developed as a tool. I think it has enormous potential. But if you're asking for straight advice, I would say the better knowledge, the better you would monitor. The better you stay engaged and present in the flight, thereby the better SA you will also monitor better. To a lot of extent, it's about managing workload first. If you manage workload, you will have the time to monitor. As soon as workload goes up and turns to stress, you're more likely to miss things. But I think it's game of communication and SA largely. In terms of eye tracking, our project is with a company called Seeing Machines. We've done some trials and a data collection, and we're developing an interface for trainers. Now, this has enormous potential because most pilots don't know where they're looking, and neither do the trainers because they mostly see the backs of trainees. There would be a lot of data generated, but we just want to know very simple things. We talked about UPRT before. Imagine that we could know what is the first thing all the pilots look at in a UPRT situation. That alone would be of interest. Is it something they're missing? So there's just a wonderful potential which we're exploring, and a lot of other people are exploring in the industry right now with eye track. And we also invented a tool to help trainers, which is called the candy bar, where we color-coded the cockpit, and you have a color-coded bar which shows where you're looking, which makes it much easier for the trainer to do their work and at the same time follow where the trainee is looking. So quite excited about the potential for making big improvements of training by eye tracking.
That's good. So you can point to the trainees in the right direction and develop proper behaviors.
The point is here that in aviation, we spent a lot of time reducing errors, which is, of course, really important. But we haven't spent the same amount of time focusing on best practice. What are people doing who get the highest grades, who are generally seen as the best pilots in the community? If we could detect what they're doing and transfer that to others, we would make everyone better. There is a strong craftsmanship tradition in the piloting, and not necessarily every good pilot will be able to explain why they are so good. Now, if we can capture more of that, that would be incredibly valuable.
And that's one of the beauties of the LUSA, Line Operational Safety Audit Program, which I got involved with back in Brazil, where you have the chance to observe those attitudes, these behaviors, the way they mitigate or they handle those errors in a positive way and bring them back into the SOPs, into the training environment. That drives us into talking about threat and error management. We talk about briefing forward, about the threats and having mitigation strategies already briefed. And so the crew knows specifically on that particular flight, which are the main threats and how you can possibly handle them to reduce the errors and the undesired outcomes. You had the two videos recently talking about reliability and resilience, especially resilience after 2020, all this COVID chaos that hit us really hard is a very popular word. But can you please go ahead and give us a little insight on those two topics that are very important as part of the CRM package and all the human factors package?
Yes, of course. Now, I should say that I haven't come up with all of this. It's a big tradition of researchers. We have names like, Sidney Dekker, Eric Hallnagel, Don Harris, and other leading researchers. But in essence, when we talk about reliability and resilience, it's the fundamentals of how we understand safety. So reliability is that I give you instructions or procedures, I train you how to carry them out, and then you go and do it. You're reliable. And in constructing those procedures, we try to predict as many things that could go wrong as possible and train you for it. You're a reliable component of the system. However, there's a limit to that. We cannot predict everything that goes wrong. And for those situations, we need pilots who are resilient, a resilient component of the aviation system. And that means that you need to be good at anything. So this is very closely linked with the focus of competences. Now, I could train you to make a decision for every specific situation and tell you in this situation do A, this situation do B, this situation C, but there's no way you would remember it, and your manuals will turn even thicker than they are now. So I could do that, or I could simply say, Ronald, I'm going to train you to be a good decision maker, and then it doesn't matter what situation you come to because you're going to be good at decision making. So we can talk about reliability is something where you have specific competences, competences that we can train and proceduralize and make sure that you can carry out in a simulator and then you can do in reality. Then we have resilience, which is training for any situation, probably something you haven't seen before or at least seen very rarely. It's not about either or. People tend to get very polarized on this issue. It's that you have to have both. And that's the important.
And when you have a chance to observe a simulator training and those things happening, it's quite interesting because most commonly pilots, they tend to try to control the situation as much as possible. And what I mean by that is that I want to go and do a sim session in a certain environment. I'm expecting A, B, and C to happen. And when moment something similar to A happens, they just throw their decision-making process out of the window and use the procedure that they are prepared to apply on that particular situation. But the problem is that A can happen slightly in a different time frame or different context. And that procedure that the guy throws automatically may not work properly. So at the end of the day, the guy has this whole syllabus of, without stopping and taking a deep breath and analyzing what's going on, he just throws the decision, and sometimes the outcome is undesirable. The beauty is really when you have a chance to see that crew that working as a team, you can throw whatever unexpected events, letting the startup event happen, and let them identify, manage, and then slow down and make a proper decision, no matter what's being thrown at them, is a definite step forward in terms of training.
If I remember right, I believe my friends back home at Scandinavian Airlines are doing things like this. They call it dilemma-based scenarios, meaning that there is no right answer. There's no black and white. There's only shades of gray, and you have to, you know, decide which shade of gray you want to try to go through. And that is incredibly important. I can add something to that because I read an incredibly interesting article about learning. As you know, as a pilot, that you sort of putting your license on the table every 6 months, it always feels a bit risky. Even for the most confident pilot, you have your concerns. And that's why you want to do what's right in every way. This article was about people playing video games and how they learned in them. And in a video game, you first learn to maneuver better and better. You get a little bit quicker. But if you're actually going to score more points, at some point you need to change strategy. And when you change strategy, then you get a little bit worse for that moment because you're learning something new, right? And the conclusion was that learning is the accretion, the slow accretion of skill and bursts of exploration. And this knocked me out because I was thinking about in most parts of the industry, there is no place for bursts of exploration in the sim. Sim time is valuable and you often have to get things right. We focus more on the accretion of skill and less on the bursts of exploration. That doesn't really help us to develop resilience. I agree with you that I think we're much better now. More scenarios are resilience-oriented, might not have a right answer, and that's good. But I still think we're very focused on that accretion of skill rather than the bursts of exploration.
And also there is the fear factor, either real or perceived by the pilot. Sometimes he doesn't really want to risk or try something different, which is a great learning opportunity if you're sitting in the right environment. I remember a study on United Airlines, the 747 sim scenario, experience training crews, and they had a situation where they were going New York to Paris, and then we have an engine oil leak, which would end up on the shutdown 1 hour after takeoff. And training department foresaw four or five possible outcomes. They were legal, they were safe, they were predictable. Surprisingly, the crew members, I think it was about 12 or 14 crew teams that faced the same scenario, and they came up with 9 different outcomes, totally safe, reliable, legal, that no one foresaw it. If the solution is not working, that's why we say stop, reassess, find a different way. Maybe you find a better way of dealing with the situation. Don't get tunnel vision into that outcome that's eventually going to take you to the wrong path.
Yeah, I know one airline in Scandinavia who trained resilience in a way that I found very interesting, where they different pilots, depending on experience, can take different amounts of risk. The risk you're taking as a 36-year experienced pilot is not the same for a very junior pilot. And they used the word brittle, you know, how far do you want to go out on the ice? And, you know, for some pilot who is very experienced, for example, of winter weather or fog, it's a normal thing. It's a normal day. They've flown in their whole life. For another one, that might be a big risk. But they want the pilots to understand how brittle, how fragile is the situation. So not only think about procedures, but also really take in the situation and think, how far do you want to go today? There will always be a difference between different pilots there.
We have this Safety for Free series and several initiatives. One of them is stabilized approach campaign. So basically, if you're not stabilized, go around. That's the safest thing you can do in such a moment. And then after you get more time in your hands, you sit down and try to understand what happened. We were talking before about stabilized approach criteria, gates, and automation, how the airlines are dealing with that. And you gave me some interesting insights. Would you mind to share that with us?
Absolutely. So there's no doubt that stabilization criteria has been an incredible successful development in making our industry more safe and incredibly valuable. However, in some parts of the industry, we've seen the reaction that when something goes wrong, where there's an incident, the reaction of the company is to add something to stabilization criteria. Oh, we need another piece here. And the stabilization criteria just grows and become bigger and bigger. Now, the problem is then that we end up in a situation where pilots are not really that present in flying the plane anymore because they're just thinking about the next step in the stabilization criteria and end up making mistakes because of that. They're not present and trying to do things now. They're trying to recall what's the next thing they need to achieve. And you lose the big picture of what you're actually doing. And what I've said about this, that this is an example not of the pilots failing the procedures, but of the procedures failing the pilots. We really need to think about how we design these things from a human factors perspective and be careful so we keep them as simple as possible.
When you look at flight data monitoring programs and the picture that's being painted in such gates, the sublighted approach gates, the flight data records, they don't give you the context, the big picture. We just have this article released about 10 points where the air traffic controllers should pay attention to avoid pushing the guys into the wrong direction and destabilizing an approach. So these are this is one example of outside factors that can play a role in such equation. The flight data monitor cannot see that. So you got to be very careful when you analyze that event. Because the moment you classify one event and depending on the company, you put the pressure on the pilot, he's going to go reactive. And the next time he may go around when it's not necessary. It's not the main objective of this process. We are here to increase the safety, operate with the proper safety margin, and not create the problem by eventually starting an unnecessary go-around, for example.
Yeah, I think as an industry, we collect a lot of data, and increasingly so, and we're very good at exploring that data, but we're not always very good at explaining it.
That's right. It's like we see nowadays a new generation of aircraft, A350, 787. They can generate 1 terabyte of data per day. To get something out of that big amount of data is time-consuming, expensive.
Typical case of over-data and under-analysis.
Now we're talking about Emirates. And I think one of the most interesting aspects of this operation is the fact that you have a multicultural cockpit with more than 100 different nationalities, different experiences and backgrounds, different expectations. Body language plays a big role, and obviously one of the videos that you also talk about, there are two factors that play a big role in this equation, which is communication and culture. Could you go a little bit into those two topics and give us your insights on what goes on in the cockpit here?
I will try. I can probably come back and do a special section about culture because it's such a, you know, rich field here. But to give you just a few highlights, people often look at Emirates from the outside and think there's so much challenges with the culture. And of course, there can be. A study by one of our 777 captains, Steve Scott, he did his PhD in 2013 and is now a lecturer at Coventry University, I'm proud to say. But he studied culture and decision making. And one of the most interesting pieces of his research was a question if pilots identify first with a national culture or with a pilot culture. And if I believe right, there was a big majority, I think upwards of 80%, who said that they identify with a professional culture as pilots first. So this is why it works well in Emirates. It's that unique thing about pilots that they have a very strong identity and a very strong professional culture. So the reason we can put, you know, people from any nation together in a cockpit and it works well is because they are first pilots, and secondly, they're Brazilian or German or Swedish or British or whatever. And so I think that's a fascinating result in itself.
Yeah, I'm aware of this study and I'm glad that it pinpointed that particular question because it was quite surprising. And you're totally right. When you go into such a flight deck, and we are a huge group of pilots, so very rarely fly again with the same crew or individual. And it just runs smoothly. People know exactly what to do. The SOPs are very strong and help to smooth out all those factors that could play a role in creating some mismatch. So, Nicklas, for your PhD thesis at Lund University, you wrote about exploring levers for improvement of basic civil aviation training. Can you tell us a little bit about what you did there during your thesis?
I certainly can. I studied mental workload to a large extent, and that was where I used heart rate monitoring, for example, also some eye movements and some other aspects, psychophysiological measurements, if you want. You know, when you do research, you do a lot of work for a very small nugget of information to add to the mountain of information. But I think one of the main points of my studies in that context was that I measured heart rate in a rejected takeoff in the simulator on student pilots, and also in a real plane. And the interesting thing was that the peak heart rate, which also indicates the peak mental workload, happened at the call of the trainer in the sim. When he called rejected takeoff, boom, the peak came up. But in reality, the peak came after the call, because you're wrestling to keep the aircraft on the runway, right? We can discuss that forever, and the simulator industry doesn't necessarily like when I bring up that. We can say that there is a difference between simulator and reality, no matter how good you make the simulator. And that's what we could see here. That peak, when you're sitting and waiting for it to happen, and you sort of actually, when it's triggered, is the peak workload, whereas in reality, you actually have to manage it. I think that was an important indication of that gap between reality and simulation, which we need to recognize. We can do a lot of things in the simulator, but there's certain things we actually have to experience to know if we're able to handle them.
Commercial aviation, as opposed to military aviation, you don't have the eject button if something goes wrong.
You have to do it as close as you can. And this, you know, simulation is getting steadily better. But that was, at the time I did those studies, quite an important. Another thing links to what we talked about before. The flight school I was at was the first one, I think, in Europe to go from an older aircraft to the Cirrus SR-21 as a training aircraft. And it's a beautiful aircraft. There's wonderful, flat screen panels and a side stick and everything. To a large extent, that transition worked very well. But coming back to what we talked about before, when the first students came up to their PPLs, there was some criticism from the external examiners that they didn't really know how to fuel calculations. They didn't have a good SA in many aspects. So they would come back to the point that if everything is given at you and you don't have to make those calculations, well, then you're not going to have the same SA. So that was a point for my studies as well.
Now that you came back into training and simulation devices and human factors, we talked in the beginning of the episode about UPRT, loss of control in flight. I had the chance to read before about one simulator in Europe that can mimic the vertical lateral accelerations. Have you had any insight on how such a training device can be more effective in simulating accelerations or situations that eventually could cause a somatographic illusion to the pilots?
Yeah, it is very difficult to fully replicate these type of illusions, but there are some simulators like the one you mentioned that is capable of that. There's also been historically some military simulators who can do this. And there's no doubt that there's a difference of just having experienced it even, you know, one or a few times and not having experienced it. However, there is some conflict in the industry about the value of that and how lasting it is, how much learning effect. If you don't get to train it enough, will the startle effect still be stronger so you can't reach those programs you need in that situation? How much do you need to train for these very rare situations to know that it's going to, you know, help trigger those programs? What's interesting with that is that in the industry, we often trained to remove risk, right? We change a procedure, we train everyone on those procedures, and the risk is gone. With startle, we can't do that. I can never train you to the extent that I can say, Ronald will never have startle effect. No. That is impossible. I cannot predict that. But what we can do is train the whole pilot population and say, on these, whatever, 1,000 pilots, we will reduce the risk for startle. But I can never, in any individual case, say he is safe and he is unsafe, because we cannot predict these type of reactions. And I think that is a very different way of thinking of training. It's more like quality assurance than the traditional training. We cannot remove the risk, but we can reduce it.
You are able to identify the startle when it happens, so then you can take protective measures and have a better outcome. And one of the last topics I would like to address in today's episode is about automation. You were kind enough to guide me through my dissertation on AI and machine learning, helping the pilots to do a better decision-making process on an in-flight diversion during cruise, which I'm very thankful for your support. I made the dissertation public for our audience. The kind of feedback I had from it was amazing. We're going to do an episode on that. I may invite you to be part of the episode if you're happy to. I have the feeling that people are going to be very interested in the topics we've been discussed here and eventually bring you back to the further episode in the near future.
Ronald, I can add that I wrote a book chapter about pilot retirement 2 years ago, and it's probably the only written account about pilot retirement. That would also be a great topic for an interview.
Okay. I'm getting there, already planning ahead.
But automation, what do you want me to talk about there?
Yeah, the automation and the fact that when I did the dissertation, people read the paper. Some of them were like, oh, Ronald, what do you think you're doing? You're an airline pilot and you're talking about automation, taking the pilot out of the loop. One of the guys that helped me in the dissertation, he's developing certain softwares in the US related to basketball, like a virtual coach. He sees the automation as something that's going to get together with the pilot. The pilot has some features that automation does not have, and the same and the other way around. So when you get automation together with the pilot and put them to work together, like in a proactive way, that's the way I see automation in the future. Should not try to focus, oh, wait, are we going to have one pilot on the flight that got rid of the other pilot? It's going to be a disaster for the workforce. What's your insights on this process right now?
I try to not have too many opinions, but at least this, I have some qualification to say something. I'm probably going to be universally hated by your audience, but I think we got to realize that we're fighting a slow and in the long term losing war against fully automated flight. You know, it's going to happen at some point. Now, that might take a long time, but single pilot operations is not far away. Dornier recently came out with news that they are building a single piloted aircraft, and I think it should be ready within a decade. And there's been research made in a pan-European project called ACROSS, from 2013 to 2016, there was extensive research made on single pilot operations. So I think it's probably very hard to say anything else that that's the direction it's going to go on long term. And that has a lot of risks. And our pilots are absolutely right in pointing out those risks. It used to be 5 or 6 in the cockpit, and now we're 2. So, you know, every one of those steps have had a risk to it. I certainly want to have 2 pilots when I go and fly in an aircraft as a passenger. I think things related to automation before, when I talked about cognitive artifacts and the competing and complementing ones. I think one thing that is incredibly tricky, that the reason we trust automation now is that we have people like you in the cockpit who can supervise it, who can take over when things go wrong, because you have a different experience. However, how is that going to work for the next generation? I think a really good example is a survey which asked how many people would like to have robotic surgery. And there was a majority who says yes. So there's quite some trust in it. But you can say yes because there will be an experienced surgeon standing and looking over the robot. Now, who is going to be the experienced surgeon? Who is going to be the experienced pilot in the next generation if they're not getting the experience? I think that transition is a real concern for me.
And you also mentioned that there are 2 topics that we'd like to talk briefly. One is a little further down on culture path and on the Boeing simulation device.
Yes. So we build what we call a mid-fidelity simulation together with Boeing. And we tested that scenario here at Emirates a few years ago. And it was quite successful. So basically, this is a scenario with a generic aircraft that you play on an iPad or a tablet. And the fascinating thing is that when it comes to simulation, the important thing is not the technical device. It's not the fidelity of the technology that's most important. It's the fidelity of the story. You've all been, you know, I mean, you've been in a classroom when someone says, this happened to me last week, and someone tells about something, a fire or smoke or something, and you're into the story. You want to listen, you want to learn, because it's such a good story. And my concern with learning is that we often focus too much on the technology and not enough to make sure we have great stories, great scenarios that really provides the learning. And that's what we do with this. We have a very simple simulation, but the story is really good. And it has an incredibly good training value for very little money. And that's something we are continuing to develop with Boeing.
That's great news, because it's something that you can directly relate to. You can pick that experience and apply it in your routine. I have to say, I love that experience we have on the ground school day. We are under all this culture umbrella. What would you like to say to close the episode today for those who are watching us?
I'd probably like just to give a taster for what we could talk about in a future maybe episode about culture, because we have had to brush in with it. But it is fascinating to work here. It's a wonderful laboratory with pilots from all corners of the world, probably about 100 nationalities. It's a wonderful experience to live in the middle of the data stream. And in terms of culture, you get to experience everything. I'd like to finish off and say, you know, just one of my observations of Brazilian colleagues. It is wonderful people, very friendly, but I just find it fascinating that, you know, they might say hi to each other in the morning, and it's not a normal hi like a Swedish person would do. It's hi, like that, you know, hug and this great warmth and everything. But what is strange to me as a Swedish person is they will meet an hour later in the corridor, and it will be the same hi. Hi, da da da. That is very Brazilian to me. And to be here and to be able to make those observations and try to understand the different cultures, and ultimately that it still works so well together in spite of our differences, that is fascinating. So the learning point I'd like people to take away is probably that if you're going to have diversity, have a lot. I think there can be a problem in an organization if you have three or four strong groups and they keep nudging against each other. In Emirates, we're so incredibly diverse that I go to one meeting, there's 10 nationalities. I go to the next meeting, there's another 10. I stop thinking about people's nationality. I just think about who are the people I like to work with and I work well with, because I can't keep track of all the nationalities.
Sitting on the flight deck on those flights, it's just a phenomenal experience. The time kind of flies, really. You get to the end of the flight and you have people from different backgrounds, ex-military, change of knowledge on those flights. This is one of the richest things that I will take away when I eventually retire in a few years. Having the chance to meet people like you, I love interacting with you during these dissertations. You were guiding me through the process and all the brief moments we had the chance to interact in those last years. Human factors is definitely one of my passions. And I did my master's now on safety. I was pushed by Laurie Earle from New Zealand to pursue a PhD into human factors in the future.
I'm looking forward to be part of your PhD supervision team.
Oh my God, you're putting pressure on me now.
not pressure, just motivation.
That's right. That's the right word. We have Captain Marcelo Taborda, who worked for several years with Emirates and now flies for Ryanair. And he's one of the main volunteers in our corps, dealing with all the interview preparation and training. And he's probably going to love watching you talk about culture and this diversity. And it's something that he really touches all the time. He goes into one of those episodes about screening and how to prepare for an interview, how this cultural aspect, when you join a different airline, when you become an expat, how is it important to know where you're putting your foot in? And it is part of the success in going through the interview and reaching your objective of getting a job. So thanks very much for all those insights. As I said, if you have a chance in the future to come back and go into different topics, it will be my pleasure.
And thank you for the opportunity. And to all your Brazilian colleagues, I'd like to say, when the world opens up, I haven't been to Brazil yet, so I'm waiting for that invite.
You need to have a few days because the country is huge and the cultural diversity is also quite interesting.